from Florissant. Her company won a $5,000 prize as part of a Sydney Uni competition, and that got her a foot in the door at Mirror D, where she and her team have been working really hard. So take it away whenever you're ready.
Thanks, Matt.
Thank you, Jason, for introduction. Thank you for being here. I'm really excited, although Jason just exited, but I had a prepared sentence, which was, I'm very excited to be here because we have our suppliers, peers, and mentors in the same room. And most of you today would probably have heard about other companies like Solange's CubeWriter, but not about my company, and there's a reason for that. We're not launching CubeSats, that's the reason. But we're doing something very important without which you can't really launch CubeSats. There is only, as we've heard from previous speakers today, there are only four real areas of application of the CubeSats, and we're taking care of one of those. And we are, as the slide says, launching the future agricultural revolution. So we're looking at remote sensing. Sorry. We are looking at earth observation, remote sensing, and we're typically applying it in agriculture. And what Jason did not know, because we haven't caught up in a while, is that we've, since university course, won three awards, and one of them is the World Bank Award of the Big Data Challenge competition. And we came third of the finalists, and the first one was in the world was the team from Stanford. And since we applied really early on, we applied with our preliminary concept, and Stanford won with the concept that is very similar to what we have now. So we don't regret losing that one, because we're essentially doing what they wanted to do, which we're doing commercially in Australia. And so what are we doing? For those of you who are familiar with remote sensing, the words hyperspectral and aerial imagery would make sense. For those of you who are not so familiar with it, I'll go through the drill of what hyperspectral is and why do you need it and what is the value and what is the idea of this business case here, really. But the important part is that my PhD is in remote sensing from aeronautical, from UAVs. It's not from CubeSats. It's not looking from satellites. And we're combining the two, and I'll speak about later why it's so important to actually combine the satellite imagery with the drone imagery that's so popular in agriculture now. So what is the value of the data? We're consuming the data and producing the value. So this is why I think why this talk is important as a part of the startup track on the CubeSat workshop, because we can inform agricultural decisions that cost money and effectively feed the world. A little bit of a backtrack to when we started. We have heard about a couple of courses, incubators, and different programs that people here presented have been a part of. And we did something that's very interesting. So who have heard about Incubate at the University of Sydney? There is an alternative, which is called Inventing the Future, where a bunch of PhDs are going, they've been locked up in the room for 4 months until they come up with four startups, out of which two survive and raise money. This is currently the throughput. So it's pretty bad, pretty good. It's not a bad idea to do that to PhDs. That's been confirmed as the world's strategy to generate, money in the name of ideas. And most of you would know Eva Cairns, who's Andrew Dempster's collaborator on quite a few projects, and he's given us initial support for our ideas on CubeSat mission before we decided that we would only do data, not the hardware. Agriculture, and when do you hear about a remote sensing for agriculture, what does it mean? I'm hoping today to broaden your outlook on that, and what is exactly the application, and what is exactly the challenge, and why when you say my CubeSat mission will include agriculture, you should consider the things that I will be talking about today, because otherwise there is no viable business case that you're making. Their decisions in agriculture are not informed. Believe it or not, when they wake up, when farmers wake up, they see the patch of the paddock that they want to see today, make a decision, and they don't have time to look at their satellite imagery, they don't have time to fly the drone, even if they bought one for their son. The reality that I'm facing with our trials, and hopefully shortly paid trials, is that we have to solve the business case. And if you wish, I'm at the later stage of the value chain, after from which you can say that all of your CubeSats, remote sensing satellites, have captured the data, and the data needs to be then processed and delivered somewhere. And Pluralsat is the company that's looking at how to process the data, how to make sense of it, and how to add value so that farmers would make use of it. And just a quick recap of why I've mentioned already a couple of times that the remote sensing in agriculture is not a solved problem. And I was thinking of putting this on a slide today because, you know, majority of you have CubeSats on the top of your list, and for me, satellite is a sentinel. And just because all the time what we are doing is looking at satellite imagery and imagery coming from other sensors. And Dmitry Ishenko in the first row here, he's our supplier of this lovely thing. So his company, Applied Infrared Remote Sensing, if I got that correctly, have given us the opportunity to have a top-notch, custom-built hyperspectral imager with 281 bands imaging in 2 nanometer resolution, which is so great and warms my heart and costs a lot of money, but that means that we can do the science in agriculture. And why am I telling you about this specific imager? Because what currently people are using is this, and Parrot Sequoia is one of the cameras. Parrot is the producer or the manufacturer of UAVs and also the sensors, and they're of great support for us as well. But this camera, as you can notice, it has 4 different bands, and those bands are approximations of what's in this camera, and this is just an analog. And currently what's happening in agriculture, when you're getting your remote sensing or your imagery, you have approximations, you have very, this is the wavelength, and most of you have really solid academic background, so I won't bother talking about it in detail, but the idea here is that this is where the visual light is, this is where infrared light comes in play, this is the red edge where all the agricultural secrets are hidden in decoding those lines. And we are looking here, for example, in hyperspectral, we would have 281 bands as slices along this horizontal line, and there'll be so many of them. Compared to the cameras that I'm telling you that they're using now, putting on those drones, or even Sentinel, which has only 13 bands, those bands are approximations, very, very wide bend in the hyperspectral band. And what is the difference? You can't do clever science with that. This is your commercial approximation of what's happening in agriculture, as opposed to the real ability to say, okay, I see that this is the aging crop, this is the old crop, this is a diseased crop, this is a healthy crop, and this is what satellite, what we're doing currently with satellite imagery, with drone imagery. We put extremely sophisticated sensors on board of the UAVs because we can't put them on the satellites to figure out how we can design or order or request less sophisticated sensors so you can guys put them on the satellite so we can produce the value for the agriculture. And I'll be talking about the value added and how it comes into play, but just as a ballpark figure, if you imagine that the 4-band camera can give you only 1 or maybe 2 important metrics that you can do something useful with, your 281-band camera gives you a full suite of tools to understand everything that is happening with your crop. You can think about it as seeing the X-ray and MRI and CT of your crop. And Pluralsat Engine is taking care of interpretation of that imagery. And just a little bit of that background, so where do we sit, where we value add? So when we started with Delta V, Brian Lane, our partnership with Delta V support team, with Brian Lane and Tim Parsons, we figured out that, yes, we do need to focus more, not on the hardware, but on the software side, on what happens to the data, because if the majority of the startups are working on hardware and they all have a problem of not being able to sell their services, as Will was saying, if you're a startup, you struggle having other startups as your client. So we've decided to be a little bit different in the regard of what we do with satellites. We decided to capture the data, to get the data that's accessible, or to order the data from the satellite to fly, or our own UAVs with those sophisticated cameras that I was talking about, to crunch all the numbers. There is some machine learning involved. Since it's a part of my PhD, it also touches other areas of my life. There is really sophisticated and really nice crop health analytics that's getting produced when it tells you where to water, where to apply fertilizer, and even where to spray. And I'll talk in details where the project is at this stage, because this is not yet all solved. This is a project in creation. I thought I would talk about competition a little bit, and I would point out why what I'm saying is really a game changer for Australian remote sensing, and especially agricultural application, because people who are doing it in the world won't be able to rock up tomorrow and say, we're taking over Australian market. Firstly, as we've recently found out from our trip to the Silicon Valley, there is no one who's really super advanced in this. So we do have a first mover advantage, especially in this market, and speaking more generally, the first mover advantage of being very application oriented and starting to fly, capturing the data and producing the data that I'll show you a little bit of later on, to the growers, to people who are our customers from day one. The other challenges that are covered in this nice slide are supposed to tell you that if you're a European like me, or some of you might be European people as well, you would know that agriculture in France is a very homogeneous thing. It's easy, it's solved. It's not as convoluted, twisted, and really hard and really harsh as in Australia. So what this is to say is that people who've done this in Europe would have lots of problems trying to get to another market. So as I mentioned before, all these great things that you're going to launch hopefully will produce the data that we will be able to dictate the requirements for, that will really make the business case happen. One of the pictures that I decided to put on the slide today, this is a nitrogen trial, and just for understanding, this, you're looking at cotton grown in Narrabri in New South Wales. Here's the picture from March. So you have a really nice sweet grown cotton crop without balls yet. And those lines are nitrogen lines. So none of the effectively available solutions for remote sensing in agriculture can, at this late, at a late stage like this, say what's happening with the crop, and we manage and do it precisely. This is our first step, and this is solved, done, and essentially we are closing contracts for that. The next stage, where we use the sophisticated imager that it's not available on a commercial basis, but where we do more R&D, is other applications in agriculture. The business model is something obviously that you would understand. We capture the data, process it, then assess the potential and get it back to the farmer. I thought I would put this slide on, although it's a more startup-y slide, but some of you might have met myself and Malcolm, and some of you might recognize the Mirity backdrop on there. But these people are really important for us, and Tim's been of great support, and Petra is incredible, Will and our advisor as well. And if you know those people, you'd just be able to connect the dots. It's our commercial partners who help us make it happen, the research institutions as well as really big players and major players in agriculture in Australia. This is the last slide, which is to say, what I'm here for today is to raise your awareness of what is really the agricultural case for remote sensing. And if you're interested in what we are doing, reach out, let us know. Thank you for your attention.
Right, well, so we have time for maybe one quick question. If anyone have quick ideas?
Just a great question.
Yeah. Yeah, so are you saying that most of the bands
but the spectral bands viewed from space at the moment are not applicable to you? And if so, is there a way that you can use the available bands to infer what's happening on other bands?
So this is exactly the R&D that we're doing now, so that we are flying sophisticated images where we don't have atmospheric correction, getting the 13 bands from the Sentinel that are the approximations of what we're seeing, trying to infer the rest, but also it informs in longer term what is the accuracy and the cost of not having the data from space for agriculture, which can then inform the decisions of the missions that you guys will be launching. What is the sensor that we need there? Why this is important and not something else is important to image, so that we can really add value.
Great.
Thank you.
Cool. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
All right, so next up.